watching Market Guru, and today's Market Guru is Sanjay Kumar, Chief Investment Officer at PNB MetLife. Sanjay, thanks very much for joining us. The beauty of managing insurance money, and I'm not talking about the unit-linked part of it, is that you can look at the world from a visionary perspective. So as you look at the world from a visionary perspective, let's say 20, 30 years out, how do you see things moving in India on the stock market, and what kind of stocks are you picking with that kind of horizon?
The recent events, what they have done is they have given the much needed correction that we are looking for. So there were many sectors, many companies that we have been wanting to buy, but because of the expensive valuations, we have not been able to do so. So this recent correction which has happened has given us a very good opportunity. And we are long-term investors, so we are not put out by this short-term fluctuations. So essentially what we are doing is capitalizing on this opportunity, looking at sectors, at companies that we find attractive, that we think are there going to create wealth over the long term, and buying them. So that's the way I look at it. So over the medium to long term, there are quite a few sectors, there are quite a few companies which will offer you good growth potential, value creation potential. So those are the companies that we are now capitalizing on. Right. And thanks to this recent set of events, yeah.
Right. So Sanjay, where do you find significant appreciation potential, or investment themes, if I may? Because largely the investment themes we have access to, oil and gas, automobiles, are investment themes based on an industrial country or a country industrializing. We don't seem to have many themes to play like Google or Starbucks, which are more service, the new India kind of a theme. So how exactly are you then building your portfolio for the long run?
Talking from the services perspective, if you look at the IT sector, you know, the IT sector is one that we have recently turned positive on. And one of the reasons for that is that the data points coming out from the US economy, the macroeconomic growth momentum there seems to be strong. And therefore, the business confidence, which there again appears to be getting stronger by the day. So what that means is that the IT spend, which we were thinking of earlier, is actually going to be bigger than what it was. So which means that the business for the Indian IT companies is going to be better this year. Apart from that, we are also seeing that the tailwind, which the INR is expected to provide, that also will provide a fillip to the earnings of Indian IT companies. So three things. One is, of course, the growth. So you will see a better top line number, you will see a tailwind from INR, and the focus on digital when you're talking of long term things. You know, Indian IT companies have been spending a lot on digital. So digital proportion as a percentage of the total revenues would be broadly in the early double digits, right? And but it's increasing at a fast pace. So that's the important part. And the investment by IT companies in digital is again gathering momentum. It has been there for many years now, but it's now gathering pace. So all this, if you combined, you will see companies in the IT sector which are long-term winners. And that's where we are capitalizing on this developed markets.
Right. So, Sanjay, one of the things I usually like to do is to go into the past to see how much can we predict of the future. And so while you were talking, I was just running some data down. And these very companies that kind of are showcase of technology. So I want to share some data. They're not by company name, I mean, but I just have to mention the company, but you don't have to get into the name. Infosys, if I held it for 1 year, gave me a 9% return. If I held it for 5 years, gave me a 41% return. So annualized, I'm not analyzed, I'm talking about 5 years. So, and even if I held it for 10 years, I only got a 14% return out of Infosys. 14% in 10 years. There was a company called On Mobile, which told us they were going to change the world of mobile. That 1 year return is negative 28%, 5 year is 31%, and 10 years negative 67%. Let's take Wipro, 19% negative in 1 year, 5 years 16% overall, and 10 year 27.6%. So when I go back, Sanjay, what sometimes I lose track of is that maybe it's English, but there's a lot of rhetoric in our country about what is happening. But and I'll come with some very interesting statistics after this. So I want to ask you, how do I predict the future when at the back, while the economy may have grown, some of these sectors have actually turned commodity? it not delivered any returns to me as a stockholder.
Okay, so that's exactly where stock picking comes at. So at this point of time, we see the IT sector as an exciting growth sector. Now within that, what we do is look at the industry leaders, right? And that's where you look at the top line, the margins, the valuations, and everything all put together. And remember, this is not static. What we do is very dynamic. So we look at it on everyday basis, every quarter basis, and keep evaluating and re-evaluating the company. So we keep revisiting them as well, right? So again, the points that you mentioned, right? So for the names that you mentioned, I have names, unfortunately I can't tell you,
sure.
Which have created enormous wealth in the IT sector, again, over a long period of time.
Right.
Okay, so the way to look at it that, well, within a sector, you identify the leaders, the winners, and then add them to your portfolio.
Sure. And you make a fair point, so I'll mention it. Actually, TCS 10-year returns are 268%, ITC's 10-year returns are 271%, and Hindustan Lever, I mean, if you look at 1 year, it may not look right, but 10-year returns are 253%. So you're absolutely right to weigh it fairly, if I may.
Sure.
Now I want to get into the fact that, you know, when you look at long-term investment themes, you also have to ask yourself, where will India really be in 20 years? Again, I want to go back. So in Jahangir's time, which was about 400 years ago, India contributed 25% of the world GDP. This is a fact, I'm not making this up. And that's why the East India Company came to talk to Jahangir, because we were making 25%. In 1949, China was poorer than us. Their GDP now is 6 times India's GDP. Brazil, I'm not even sure where it was in 1949, but as of today, GDP of Brazil is exactly the same as India, with India having 25 times more population. Somewhere I wonder, where is the India story? I mean, if you're running the Olympics, you're just slipping down while the other guys are climbing up.
Okay, so
I mean, I don't know if you're allowed to invest in foreign countries or not as yet.
Okay, so there are a few parts to the responses that I want to give you for the questions. One is, let's look at the demonetization theme, what this has done. So this has immense medium and long-term benefits, right? So so whether you look at the tax compliance part, or you look at formalizing part of the parallel economy, or overall, you know, widening the benefits from a fiscal front, there are many, many benefits to this. On top of that, add the GST angle. Okay, so the GST implementation will kind of bring in efficiency, productivity to the entire economy for all sectors. Look at the reforms which have been done. Before we started with the demonetization, almost every sector, be it banking, metals, power, stalled projects, the government worked on a huge set of reforms, the bankruptcy code, for example. So all these elements put together are structurally translating into India into a long-term growth story.
Mm-hmm.
And add to this the consumption theme. You know, the consumption theme that we're talking about, the 7th pay commission, ORAP recommendation, and so on. All this is still very much there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if you put all that in a package, you see a country which is going to get back to the GDP that it was and possibly add a few percentage points or more to it. So have a slightly medium to long-term point of view, and you will see the India GDP do very well, the India growth story do very well.
Sure. So, as you know, I have a very long-term perspective because I started from Jahangir. I was hoping that 400 years will give us that perspective. And I want to ask you this. Is demonetization really a hygiene factor? Because, you know, we went through something called dematerialization of shares. Okay, so you dematerialized the shares and you made the procedure better, but procedure doesn't increase the number of investors by 20 times. The equity investors have stayed the same. That's one. And two, my question is that we've got $185 billion, if I understand correctly, till now. Now, it looks like a huge number, but when I divide $185 billion with 1.25 billion people, it comes to $160. So per Indian, I've collected 11,000 rupees. 11,000 rupees, that's it? That's the amount of black money per person, per capita? $160? So Sanjay, when I give you that overall perspective, the number doesn't look, I mean, it looks like diddly squat.
Okay, so I'll not get into the numbers at this point of time. You know, I'll rather wait for the official numbers to
It's
come
official.
Out.
185 billion is what the government of India says they've collected.
Okay, so that was quite a few days back, right?
Okay,
so let the numbers come out. Then we can talk about how much has been collected, how much has been exchanged, and so on. So the way I look at it, it is that you have within the cash economy, there is a formal economy, and there is the unaccounted cash that you have,
sure.
Right? So the objective was to try and curb this cash, which is the black economy, you know, the black cash. Mm-hmm. Now, how successful the government is that, how what the numbers pan out to be, what the final numbers are, what the tax collection from this comes out. I mean, let's wait and see. It's like a transition which is happening.
Sure.
Transition always brings in some kind of disruption.
Sure.
It's too early. It's not even a month since the scheme was rolled out.
Sure.
So I would hold on to my comments here.
Sure.
What you should see is that this demonetization, it has done two very big things. There was a parallel economy running in India,
mm-hmm.
right? The unaccounted economy. It will bring significant part of that into the formal economy.
Mm-hmm.
That's one. That will increase your tax collections in a big way.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, this is recurring. This is not one time. This is recurring. The widening of the tax base is recurring. The revenues that the government would get, it could be, it can be used for many activity. Let's say just infrastructure, spending. And if you do infrastructure spending in the areas of roads, railways, and so on, so these have huge multiplier effect to the economy.
Sure.
Right. So, for example, look at the digital push. What the digital push is doing is increasing the number of banking transactions.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have more money with the banks, you know, again, the credit uptake and again, the multiplier effect, job creation, everything starts happening.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if you look at a long term perspective of this, there are huge positives.
Sure.
Okay.
So, Sanjay, I wanted to just come back to, demand. And revenues, government revenues only come if there is demand push, which is that that actually people's incomes are going up, that they're earning something to pay the tax, because the tax can't be collected. Now, we can either take a socialist view that all the money should be with the government and then they'll build your hospitals and the schools, and then we have a Cuba in place or Russia in place. But since we're talking capitalist markets, we need private enterprise. Now, I want to ask you, given the scenario as we are in right now, is capital formation happening in the private sector? Two, since we don't know our unemployment rate and there is no official figure of the unemployment, what is our unemployment rate? Because first you need employment, two, you need private capital formation before I can pay my tax.
Okay, so there are two parts to this capital formation. One is, of course, the public expenditure which the government has been doing. So the government has been spending money on infrastructure and various other activities in a big way, and that it continues to do, right? And even after demonetization, that activity will continue, probably gathers momentum. So that is creating this thing. Capital formation is happening in that area. As far as the private capex is concerned, that has been weak, that we have been talking about for the last few years. Now, that has not been picking up. The reasons are, of course, low capacity utilization and weak demand. Yes, if this was to pick up, okay, and sooner or later this will pick up, then you will see job creation happening in a faster way,
mm-hmm.
right? Now, for both, if both public and private start creating this capital, then of course you will see again the huge growth momentum in the economy. Mm-hmm. But till the time we have private capex come back, this capital formation will be weak. And in my opinion, it will take a couple of years for private capex to come back.
Sure. So now let's get into how do we play this theme. Let's assume that this digital theme is very good. Now, I remember on November 8th, without getting into names, I could think of one or two e-wallet companies that I could possibly put my money. By the time we are in December 6th, I almost see some 100 wallet companies, and suddenly all your banks like HDFC and all who were not part of all of this have woken up. And then the government comes up with something called the Unified Payment Interface, almost killing all wallets, because you don't really need a wallet. You can straight be on interface and that. So while you have this digital economy, the question becomes, how do I execute an investment or trade to play this digital economy? And to me, it looks like a lot of these stocks are going through diminishing returns. So you can share that thought with me, Sanjay, because what sometimes happens is that as soon as an idea becomes mainstream, the stocks start to suffer.
Okay. I would rather look at it the other way. So, for example, consider a bank which offers digital services and all digital services, right? So what then happens is that customers, right, existing customers as well as new customers, they start transacting with the bank in one way or the other, let's say through debit cards or through the e-wallets that you mentioned. This leads to multiple advantages for the bank. One is, with the number of transactions increasing, it earns income on each of them. The other one is that it's CASA. Right, the deposits that are kept, the CASA, that starts increasing, okay, which therefore lowers its cost of capital. And to that extent, again, then it can afford to lower its lending rate. You know, so all this multiplied together has many advantages, even for companies which offer e-wallet.
All right. I want to ask you about infrastructure now and scale. So I'll take airports as an example. We have the Taj Mahal here, and we receive 5 million tourists, maybe 7 million. I'll be very charitable about it, and out of which I'm sure 70% are NRIs. So compared to a China that receives 133 million tourists, Thailand, 30 million tourists, Malaysians, 17 million population, 30 million tourists. Explain to me, Sanjay, what's wrong? I mean, it's been 70 years, right? I mean, I can talk about the next 20 years, but I mean, the scale is just not there. I mean, we're running a 50cc moped, but we want to believe this is a 1,000 or 10,000cc jumbo jet. Sounds good in English, but where is it? Where is it in the last 70 years? Because some of these countries were banana republics at that point when we had independence.
Okay, so of course, you know, this tourism is a kind of something which the government has been promoting. You can start from the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, right? And there are many other activities which have been done. But the way I look at it is that India is a developing economy, mm-hmm. and when you are in that process, you go through various transitory phases, and we are in the process where we have migrated from, let's say, a small scale kind of thing into a medium scale in many sectors. But in various other sectors, like the ones that you mentioned, let's say in airports, what is coming up is that now even smaller cities, smaller towns are getting airports. Mm-hmm. So airport is one of the basic necessities mm-hmm. that you need if you want to promote tourism. And airports so far have been restricted to a few large cities and maybe some smaller ones. So if we have, I mean, huge focus on airports,
sure.
And again, as I mentioned, roads, railways, airports, they have a huge multiplier effect mm-hmm. On the economy. Mm-hmm. And tourism could be one of the biggest gainers.
Right. So just to share with you, a small craggy island which Jardine built using, I think it was Gigi Boy or one of those guys called Hong Kong, last year received 60 million tourists, 10 times the Republic of India. That's the difference in scale that we're talking about. Okay, so now let's talk about where do we see the scale, Sanjay? Where does the scale come? Because I'm not talking about 20% growth, 30% growth. I'm talking about actually exponential growth, the Dubai-style growth, which is saying, I'm going to build and then people are going to come, not let the people crowd all over the place and I'll build something small. Where do you see that happening? In chemicals, in textiles, somewhere where we can think scale.
Okay, so I see that we already have scale in oil, for example, in oil refinery. So, for example, if you look at some of the refineries that we have, you know, they have huge capacities and almost comparable with the biggest in the world. Now, these refineries were built over a long period of time. They were the execution took quite some time. Now they are properly functioning, and the output you can compare it with some of the biggest refineries in the world. So, in those kind of sectors, you know, where we have real big, entrepreneurs putting money into areas where you think we can have scale. So, for example, commodity being one of them, right? There we can have scale. On the consumption side also, I think we'll start seeing scale very soon, right? So, for example, some of our companies that you see, let's say the services side again, IT. If I could come back to, if you look at their revenues, their market cap, it's comparable to quite a few large companies that we have globally.
And now, just in terms of how we see the distribution of earnings, let's look at the small and mid-cap side of the market. How do you see digitization impacting them? Which is, if we have such large-scale, if I may say, economic disruption, and disruption can be positive or negative, I'm just talking about disruption, how many of them do you think have the hurdle rate to actually survive? Because some of these guys are, you know, working on 3%, 2% margins. In which sectors do you think we will see large-scale, you know, creative destruction, if I may?
You know, the way, if the small companies, the small and mid-cap company that you spoke about, if they use digital in the right way, it can lead to a lot of cost saving for them. Mm-hmm. And that's where the margin that you spoke about, even without adding, you know, physical infrastructure, manpower, additional manpower, etc. This digital can provide a good boost to their margins, mm-hmm. and that's why it will come handy for them.
So you think largely the smaller companies should benefit from what's going on. So let me take another...
I would say all across.
So let me ask you, which part of the markets which are still mid-cap, like, you know, there are auto ancillaries, chemicals, where we really don't have some significantly large companies. What industry do you see in the next 5-10 years actually turning into large cap businesses? Perhaps that's where the investment team or opportunity may be.
Again, as I said, if you look at our Nifty, mm-hmm. Composition, two of the largest constituents there are the financial services, the banking and financial services, and again the consumption theme. Now, within banking, right, there are quite a few names which have small scale but are hugely capital efficient. Mm-hmm. I mean, very good financial numbers, right? High capitalization, high profitability numbers, good margins. Some of the small banks we think can translate into like very huge banks going forward. Sure. So for the next 5-10 years, this can really become big. Their CASA can improve significantly, and all financial parameters they can show improvement on.
Sure.
And in fact, many of them are very high on digital.
Sure. Do you think there's a large opportunity in the transport infrastructure from a stockholding perspective, which is as the infrastructure scales up, you know, I mean, I can't see ourselves going from 7 million to 133, chalo, we'll go to 20 million, I'll take a general assumption, but that will require massive infrastructure anyway. Do you think that will translate into longer term investment themes for stocks?
Infrastructure, especially urban infrastructure, that can be a big theme for stocks. So that's a sector where you can do good bottom-up picking, and that is a sector actually where there are broadly only small companies, small and medium-sized companies. And these companies, most of them in the engineering construction business, many of them have the potential to become really large companies.
So then I want to take two examples. The two major airports this country has, which is Delhi and Bombay, are held by companies that are in a debt trap. So that's where I was coming from, Sanjay, that if they are in a debt trap, India's largest infrastructure company fires 10% of its workforce. Why is this infrastructure growth not translating into stocks?
Okay, so as I said, in the infrastructure theme, the transport infrastructure theme, and the urban theme that we are talking about, there are quite a few names where the leverage is not so high. And they have been, doing very well on the financial front. Their margins, their growth has been good. What one needs to see is that this, the contracts that they get, you know, and the value of the contracts that they have in their book at any point of time is something that we need to constantly monitor. And as long as they are doing good on the few parameters that one tracks infrastructure, construction, engineering companies on, one should be comfortable. But I must reiterate here that this is a bottom-up stock picking sector.
Sure. Do you think it's time to restructure or revalue the traditional private sector banks, because they enjoyed an oligopoly for almost two decades? They enjoyed crowded trades because everybody got into them to play the India story. Now you have a choice of 50 banks. Now we don't even know what banks will look like, whether they will look like payment banks, whether they'll look like this bank or that bank. Is it possible that the private sector banks, the 4 or 5 or 6, will need to be structurally revalued? Just the stock price, I mean.
So, you know, the portfolio that one can choose from the private sector banks, that is becoming bigger, mm-hmm. right? And then within that now, you have the option to choose private sector banks which are small, which are medium, which are large. Mm-hmm. So to that extent, one has to look at the valuation, because many of them are quite similar in terms of financial parameters that typically an analyst looks at. Right. So within that gamut, one now has a broader flexibility, and one again, here again, you know, once you're comfortable with the sector, it comes to again bottom up stock picking and valuations.
All right, Sanjay, thanks very much for that conversation.
It
was
Thank you so much.
Interesting conversation. I hope you enjoyed that. And that was Sanjay, who is Chief Investment Officer at PNB MetLife. On this edition of Market Guru, that's all we have. Thank you for joining us. Goodbye.
Thank you.